It's a local music spotlight on Lake Effect Radio.
Voodoo Brothers, Terrible.
Hello, everybody. You're listening to the Kevin Baxter Power Hour. Kevin's feeling a wee bit under the weather today. I'm Tom.
And I'm Jeremiah. But it's actually the train wreck of the
We're calling
Baxter
it the
Power
train
Hour.
Yeah.
I just like doing that. This is because you feel under the weather, Kevin. I'm sorry. But we have our friends from Geauga Metro Parks.
Geauga Park District.
Wow.
Get it right, man.
You're already having a great day, aren't you, Jeremiah?
Yeah, parks is parks, right?
It's okay. Next time. You can make up for it next time.
Yeah, I'll have to make up for it next time. Darn. Except we got to start the Tim counter. How long is it going to take him until he's actually going to respond? This time we're going to actually go and do this right. I have the counter going on there, so when he answers, we can actually figure it out.
All right. Hi, Tim.
If he's listening, we'll find out very shortly.
We will.
But to start off.
All right. So, so you're the Geauga Park District. Are there multiple parks? Is it just one park? Go ahead.
We have quite a few parks, what we have now. How many open to the public?
19 open parks.
19 open to the public. Parks, reservations, preserves in Geauga County. And these are tax-supported by property tax levy passed by our citizens in Geauga County. And we are just over, we're 50-some years old now. Mm-hmm. We're 50-somethings, cool. Yeah. We've been around a while. Yeah.
And you're talking about how you have preserves. Are the parks specialized to do certain things?
All of our parks do protect natural areas, woodlands, various forest types, different kind of wetlands. A lot of our Geauga County is the land of headwater streams, where major rivers like the Chagrin, the Cuyahoga, and the Grand River all have their headwaters in Geauga County. So we have a vast network of small streams.
All right, so...
Just as a bit of introduction, you're talking to Dan Best. He's our senior naturalist on staff. And you've been with the park for how long, Dan?
27 years.
Okay. And you would be?
I'm Sandy Ward. I work in the marketing department.
Okay. All right, so are there any special programs that people can enter at the Geauga Park District?
Well, we have our website, geaugaparkdistrict.org. Features a very diversified palette of programs, which we offer to the public for their participation. Some are by reservation, but most are not. We provide programming for preschoolers, or their Timber Tots program, right on up to senior adults with their Geauga Walkers, for example, with lots in between that appeal to not only different age groups, but different interests as well, from nature related to outdoor recreation appropriate for our parks, and a lot of local history and so forth like that. We just are finishing up our maple sugaring season, and even though the weather hasn't allowed any of the maple producers to make a whole lot in the way of syrup, the winter that won't let go, the winter that won't die, nonetheless, our program has been very well attended.
Cool.
That's a very true point. After, what, Sunday?
Yeah.
Snow again, really.
And, yeah, and today, case in point, too.
Yeah, the weather's just so up and down.
It's more down.
More down lately.
Well, that's what they say about Ohio. It changes every 5 minutes.
Well, yeah, yes. But this has been exceptional winter. And but nonetheless, nature is moving on towards spring. Looking at the arrival of birds and so forth, everything is on track. I think the vegetation's going to be held back a little bit. But you know, things will warm up, and then we'll go from winter to summer. That's what will happen.
I hope to God.
Yeah, I had an update on my phone yesterday from Time Hop. 2 years ago, there were flowering trees right now. Mm-hmm. So. It just varies.
I remember, I believe I've seen trees that were actually budding and bushes, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden started something. I was like, why are we doing this? This is not right.
Again, right. You know, one neat thing about our programming on our website, which is geaugaparkdistrict.org, is that you can click find a program /event, and then from there, select your interest. There's a drop-down menu where you can select something like birding or exercise or, you know, youth-oriented, and you can select the type of interest that you have. So let's say you wanted to go to the park specifically for birding programs this spring. You could select birding, and then from that, see a drop-down of all the programs that the naturalists have scheduled that will take you on bird walks throughout the spring, which there are a number of opportunities in that realm this year. Oh, every year, but in particular this year, one that I found interesting, and maybe it's happened year to year is the Bird Walk for Beginners.
Yeah, recognizing that birding or bird watching now ranks among the top, right up there in the top five, if not the, I've even heard quoted the second most popular outdoor activity in America these days. So, when I was a kid, you know, being interested in birds or bird watching was that was for nerds, bird nerds, you know, and you know, it was me and one other kid on the street, and we were it for the whole town. But yeah, we took a lot of it was. On the playground, we took a lot of heat. It was very character building, but nonetheless, we persevered, and now only to find that we are surrounded by people of all ages interested in birding as an outdoor pursuit, or bird watching is a very relaxing and fascinating, entertaining activity. So, yeah, we did. It was, I think, the first Sunday in May. We're having introduction and to bird watching, helping people in their entry into this and discovering the joys, satisfactions, and the fun of being a fan of our feathered friends. And that goes along too. We do have a there's been a tradition that's now I think over 80 years old in Cleveland, the greater Cleveland area, the annual spring bird walks that are hosted by various institutions and agencies, such as Cleveland Museum of Natural History and Holden Arboretum, and yes, the Metro Parks of Cleveland, Lake, or Lorain counties. But yes, and it's all part of a very time-honored tradition. Sunday morning bird walks run last three in April, first three in May, and we've been part of that for 20-some years ourselves, too. So. But it's not all birds. No, we have programs that we try to capitalize on nature's calendar of events, as nature holds its own calendar, and we try and hook into that to expose people, to give the people these very memorable experiences of it might be frogs and peepers and so forth, and salamanders that converge upon woodland pools, vernal pools in the spring, and a hotline program, which, sorry to say, is already full. waiting for the first warm, rainy night. But we do have one later on, Memorial Day weekend, focusing on the next wave of amphibians, the tree frogs. So that and... Well, gosh, I don't know where to begin with all our diversity of programming, too. But
well, actually, one of the things was I was looking, and I saw one of the programs was something called geocaching.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that? Like, what exactly is it? What programs do you have for that?
Well, geocaching is a program that has, in the last decade, really evolved with the advances in technology, particularly in satellite
GPS.
Yes. Thank you.
Gotcha.
Yeah, the GPS, exactly. And it's kind of a jumping off point from traditional orienteering, map and compass orienteering, but now this is using the GPS units, the satellite connection there to find your location, know your location, and in this case to locate what we call our geocaches, which is a like a little prize box, and
yeah.
you know it's not like going to the doctor's office and you know getting, because you were a good kid and didn't cry when you get a shot, you get a little thump from the prize box. But the
soccer.
Yeah. but the point is the satisfaction is you actually found this thing from just you know coordinates, and you punch them in, and then you find this box in the woods, and you kind of leave your little Kilroy was here there, and it's been a fun network of activities. It remains very popular, and that's something we provide for our, again, another way, always looking for different venues, different ways of getting people outdoors, and so they can establish their bonds with the natural world, which, as we contend, really adds to the quality of life and enriches their life. So whether it's programming or people having various ways to get out in the parks, enjoying nature, the relaxation, the rejuvenation, so forth, the mental, spiritual, and physical health aspect. We always constantly looking for diverse ways to do that.
Mm-hmm. Very true. Especially because yesterday Tim was sitting here looking over a few of his. What was it? Like 5 o'clock last night. The oldest one he found was started in 2001.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's been doing it a long time.
It's like, really? I didn't realize it was back then.
Well, back then, I think, I mean, even still today, they sell the actual handheld pieces that you can use, you know. Mm-hmm. You had to buy a special controller type of thing for that back then. Now, I think that they have apps on your cell phone you can download to take you right to, you know, to navigate you through the woods to the coordinates.
Right. And mm-hmm. that, you know, that's geocaching is one thing. We, if the ice ever melts, we'll be able to get back on the waters. Canoe and kayaking programs that we host. Cross-country skiing is an extended season. But, lots of opportunities. And I think you were wanting to know about new developments in the park district, and probably one of the most exciting projects we have is finishing up the last leg, the third phase of our Maple Highlands Trail, which tend to call it a bike trail, and certainly that bicycling is one of the non-motorized bicycling is certainly the primary way people enjoy that trail. But as a paved trail, it also accommodates joggers, hikers, strollers, baby strollers, people even doing off-season cross-country skiing on wheeled skis or rollerblades.
Rollerblades. Those bikes that people lay down and like.
Yeah.
I've seen all sorts of neat bikes on the trail.
Yeah. And you know what? The Amish community, their young ladies should start their own roller derby team, because mm-hmm. they will get on that trail with their rollerblades and go from Middlefield all the way up to Clarendon, you know, do like a 10-mile loop and just smoking
on those exercise.
Speeding everyone down there.
Yeah. So, so it's that whole trail, which is the old Baldwin, Ohio Lake Branch that ran kind of diagonally from southeast to up to northern Geauga County.
Railroad,
yes. Mm-hmm. What did I say?
You just didn't say the word train. Yeah.
Train, yes. The B&O, Lake Branch, railroad line, that's right, yeah. Hauled coal from West Virginia through Youngstown on up to the lake ports to feed the power plants, and then brought down limestone and iron ore from the Great Lakes ports down to the Youngstown steel mill. So that, but that its day was pretty much over by the late 70s. And so after many years of planning and funding delays, we have that was built with federal money, and it's now a trail available for a wide diversity of use, and horseback riding in some areas too, mm-hmm. and some portions of it, particularly the middle portion, I think.
The southern portion.
The one that we're going to build, right, from Burton Station on down through Middlefield. So
that portion is currently under construction. As soon as the weather breaks, the construction resumes, and then this summer we should have a big announcement on availability of use. That southern portion will also be available for buggies to use down south. Cool. So, you know, that's why horses are available. It's not a paved surface like the rest of the trail. It's a crushed limestone. You can still ride your bike on it, but it also accommodates buggies. And
that portion also will feature two timber frame construction, traditional constructed covered bridges.
They are awesome.
Wooden decks and so forth. And so... Yeah, it's going
to
be.
We'll have a lot to talk about. Yeah, as soon as it opens up, trust me, we'll be talking a lot about it.
Mm. And our guys who built that, our construction crew, very talented group of artisans, craftspeople. It's amazing. They won an award for that.
They did. Parks and Recreation Association Governor's Award this year. They were up against, oh goodness,
some big projects. Yeah,
I think 20s of different people, different groups that built, constructed parks, water parks, and other types of big treehouse fort things. Usually contracted out. Well, our three guys, they built it themselves. Just the three of them. This big covered bridge, and just wait till you see it. Just the fact that these three guys built it is incredible. So they won the statewide award this year for that. Cool. So that's Isaiah Shipman, Tom Salo, and Steve George.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Props. I want to get the names out there, yes.
Yeah. Well, we're very proud of them, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Understandable.
So anyone can go hire a contractor. Come on.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, they just, they do the work for the park, and they also have this incredible skill set to build a covered bridge. And so you say covered bridge, and I didn't really know what I was going to be looking at when I saw it until I was there. And then it'll surprise you how cool it is. Oh, yeah. So,
and speaking of skill sets, we are currently featuring this year, has been open since November 1st, our Something's Afoot, Nature Just Can't Stay Put exhibit, which puts a focus on the way animals principally, but also even plants and water and rock and so forth, move around the natural, get from one place to another. So mobility in the natural world. Lots of fun hands-on exhibits. We're getting rave reviews from our visitors in terms of having a variety of exhibit features featuring a lot of video work done by the Auburn Career Center Interactive Multimedia Technology class. Did a super job for us providing a very lively set of videos, give us examples of all different concepts of movement among animals principally. We look at migration, we look, flying, swimming, hopping, jumping, all those kind of things.
Just to jump in here real quick, this is at the Westwoods
Nature Center
in Russell Township, and it's open daily, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. So any day of the week that you have a little bit of time to come down and check it out. It's called Something's Afoot, Nature Just Can't Stay Put. So
yeah, and it will be open at least through the fall, well into the fall, but don't... that said, don't wait and then find out, oh gosh, it's gone. It won't be there forever. But
there's something for every age there. I mean, I had my 15-month-old son there just touching things and looking at things and studying various mounts and other things that we have there. But then, obviously someone of our age also, there's so much to read and learn and hands-on. There's a big, tell them about the table, the big air table, because it's...
Oh, yeah. This is just an example of learn by doing. And one of the natural phenomenons we have, we have I-90 that parallels the Lake Erie shoreline here. And the Lake Erie shoreline region is sort of an avian interstate, too. It's a major route for bird migration. And one of the phenomenon is in the spring is you get a major hawk migration or birds of prey migration. People don't know about that, but where you get the cold breezes coming in off the lake and the land starts to warm up. Some days, we do get a bright sunny day and the land warms up, so you get this warm, buoyant air over the land surface. This cold air rushes in to displace it, and it results in just a whole line hole of rising air currents of thermals and updrafts, and these birds of prey just ride this. They just kind of spiral up on an updraft and then move over to another one when that gives out, and that's how they make their way through the Great Lakes region. So we built a fun exhibit based on air hockey table. Mm-hmm. Essentially built an air hockey table, but totally reconfigured it where the hockey pucks float on. You find the currents of air, which are the migration routes, and you hit the shoreline, a little nudge of the finger, and you send that bird to Pennsylvania, to Erie, Pennsylvania. Yeah. So it's
because they mostly glide. As long as they can.
Sore,
I bet.
Because you think of them as powerful flyers, but as far as being long-distance flyers, they're weak compared to the little songbirds as far as flight muscles. They need that help.
We saw some turkey vultures over Chardon yesterday. They're coming back? They're already here?
They've been back. I'll tell you a little secret. And I'll hear about this from all my good friends at Cleveland Metro Parks, but, you know, time they have their buzzard day on March 15th, in most years, the turkey vulture's been back 2-3 weeks already. But I guess if I was making a big, giant event and serving lots of pancakes over there at Hinkley Reservation,
you want to be sure that they're
so it's a safe date.
Yeah.
But, yeah, gosh. We have, other events. Caveman Crawl.
Caveman Crawl?
Yeah.
Want to hear about Caveman Crawl?
Yeah, they do.
Maybe we can go to a commercial first, and then...
Or we can kill another 3 minutes.
We can do three minutes. All right, I can kill 3 minutes with the Caveman Crawl.
The Caveman Crawl.
So the Caveman Crawl is Sunday, June 8th, and it's held at the Westwoods Nature Center. Over there at the Westwoods Park in Russell Township. It is a caveman-themed 5K. So... You just have to see it to understand it, I suppose. The mascot is a caveman from our Ansel's Cave over at the Westwoods. And his name is Thor. He is
in training.
You name your cavemen. Okay.
Yeah. Well, this particular one came with a name. Yeah.
Or is it off the movie, Thor?
No.
So it's a 5K. It goes through the woods, so it's unique in the way that it's not on pavement, you know, the whole time. You actually go through the woods, and it's a challenging course. So, but you can walk it. Plenty of families do it. Kids are all ages. Different age categories, and male and female win prizes at the end. There's an award ceremony afterwards. The cool thing about this year is that as soon as you cross the finish line, you'll have the results on your phone or wherever you decided to have the results sent to, so it's almost immediate, and you can share it, you know, on Facebook and whatnot. They have it all hooked up so that you can just, you get your results, you just shoot them right out there, and look what I just did. So that's pretty cool. Mm.
Technology's great.
I know, it's getting better.
Technology is awesome.
Better and better.
Sometimes. Sometimes it still has its downfall.
We take a lot of pictures of the Caveman Crawl, too, so, you know, as soon as the race is over, within the next day or two, we've got a ton of pictures, hundreds of pictures up on Facebook that you can find your friends and family and share that as well, or just, you know, frame it, put it on your...
Or you can go to YouTube and see training videos by our caveman.
The caveman has some YouTube videos.
Caveman training videos.
Yes, look up, just go to YouTube, put in Caveman Crawl, and you'll get
it remains to be seen whether or not he's actually out of hibernation yet because of the weather.
Yeah,
so I would hope. I mean, he'll be behind on his training if he's not up and at him right now. It is June 8th. It's a Sunday. And it's a really good time. Costumes encouraged, you know, to make him feel a little less awkward being around all of us. We need to dress up.
Believe it or not, there is an element of shyness in him. He feels very conspicuous if he's the only ones out there in animal skin. So,
And just as an incentive, we do give prizes for the best costume as well in a youth and adult category. Okay. So, they're very nice handcrafted wooden things that we build at the park because they're, you know, wood, very primitive. Mm-hmm. But the highlight of the whole event is running in the woods, you know, just being like sometimes... The last few, this is our fourth annual event, and we've always been really lucky with good weather. But, you know, by June, sometimes it can be kind of warm and kind of humid in the morning. You get in the woods, and it's cool, you know, and it's just the beginning of the day. It's a really nice event to be part of. Also, it's a fundraiser for our Chip Henry Institute, which is... funding all of our summer camps and other youth programming. So it's all the money that goes toward it is going to a good cause. You can get more details about the race and the fees. It's I think it's a $20 pre-registration fee, $25 on race day. A lot of people surprisingly wait to race day just because you're not sure what the weather's going to be like or how you're going to feel that day. Yeah. But if you pre-register, you'll be guaranteed to get a T-shirt. I think the first 250 people who pre-register. So it's an incentive. The T-shirts are very cool this year. They may or may not feature a certain caveman.
Yeah. But the Chip Henry Institute, yes, is the beneficiary of the race proceeds, but that goes to help fund our summer camp program for kids. That's been its second year coming up, and
registration is open for that right now online. So if you go to geaugaparkdistrict.org, and
great outdoor
things to do summer camps
for kids of quite an age range.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it's break time.
Yep, yes, yep. Definitely sounds like a break to me.
We'll be back short. Oh, except John, sweet. What do you want to see, or how could you see that? What do you want to see? Some. Yeah, I'm looking at his question. No, how could I see that? What's that?
What are you looking for, John?
Yeah.
You gotta tell me that. Ha, that, ha.
We'll answer that question.
Just a face in the crowd, and gonna heal my voice when I sigh.
Except we're back again, and still yet, no Tim.
Huh. Maybe he overslept.
No, I know he's actually on campus working in that.
Yeah, we know he's here. It's just, where is Tim?
Yeah, 33 minutes, and still yet, no Tim sighting.
That's bizarre. No, a little eerie.
My muse been out of it, out of today.
Yeah.
Seeing how long Tim would take to respond.
So one day that you time it.
So
one day that you time it is the day that he doesn't show up.
I know, he's gonna let me down. God.
All right, so some of the other things, any events that are coming up within the next week. I saw on the website that today you have something called the Geauga Walkers.
Right, that is a walking, hiking program that we partner with the Geauga Department on Aging. And they are registered through that. And we hold those in our, not only our park, within Geauga Park District, but some of the neighboring park districts too. So it's gets around geographically a little more. And these are kind of not strenuous walks. It's a lot of our seniors that really enjoy being outside and enjoy keeping up, keeping in good shape. We take it at a slow, leisurely pace. We enjoy some nature study, nature interpretation along the way. It's just a very pleasurable, not only recreation experience, but great social experience for seniors too. So, been very popular.
Yeah, meet one another, grab some friends, and that in the process, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's
yeah,
a good meeting process.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
A lot of the programs are actually, I think, you know, mm-hmm. People with typical interests gravitate toward the same programs, and then.
Well, there's a social aspect of all of our programming in the park district, and we certainly recognize that. People aren't just coming to learn something. Of course, that's I expect that's one of their main motivations, but they're also out to, like as Sandy's indicating here, mix, rub elbows with like-minded people, people similar interests. Get out and socialize, too. So that's all part of it.
Another one I saw was the Mapletown Tune Traders. That's Thursday?
This coming Thursday. It runs the fourth Thursday of the month, which, with the exception of November, which tends to be Thanksgiving. So run on the third Thursday. But anyway, fourth Thursday of the month. We've been doing this now. This is our eighth year, and we've our format's evolved a bit. What we do is we feature for the first hour and a half is a series of 15-minute performance spots, sort of like typical open mic or coffee house format. And this has attracted some wonderful local talent. We have a nice stage. It's a very low key, low pressure kind of thing. We do encourage musicians of all levels. So that aspect of it, the performance aspect, and then we have, if there's interest there in our audience, again, we're trying to build up our audience too. It's not just support group for performers here. It's meant to attract an audience too. And by way of audience participation, we do, to the extent the interest is there, we'll do a little bit of a sing-along, introduce some new and old material there for people to join in. And then we kind of go into a round the circle sort of jam where people will put a song out there and play it, and people are welcome to play along with it. And it's really interesting to see. Even though we do welcome and encourage all genres of music, we kind of inadvertently end up with folk or acoustic-based, you know, new and old folk-type music. Mm-hmm. And that includes some, you know, pop songs, too, and that kind of thing done in acoustic format, although we will not turn away an electric guitar. We say gently amplified, so, you know, don't come in there with a giant, you know, refrigerator-sized Marshall amp, but, if you do, you know, just keep it down. and it's worked very well. We do have a piano there, more or less in tune. But it's worked out very well. And again, it's a nice, encouraging, nurturing, supportive kind of atmosphere for people who are novices in music, are not polished yet. They kind of work their way from the jam up into the performance thing. We've seen people evolve to that point. And it's another way, again, of, you know, the Park District has always had a recognized and promoted the inspiration or influence of nature on the arts, whether it's music or the fine arts or whatever. Mm-hmm. And this is another expression of that. So,
yeah, that's even just as simple as being in a beautiful natural place while mm-hmm. you're painting or while you're writing or while you're playing music. The Maple Town Tune Traders, that also happens at the West Woods.
Yes.
In Russell mm-hmm. Township. That's a nature center. It's a beautiful nature center, and that is from 7 to 10 p.m.
Yes.
So that's in an evening on a Thursday evening.
I was about to ask when that was going down, where it was going down.
Yeah, and that's a non-registration program, so you can just walk right in, you know, if you have that.
That's the name of the song, Walk Right In, Sit Right Down. But
at least he was thinking what I was thinking.
Yeah, that's if you want a performance spot, it's as you arrive, sign up. So first come, first serve on that. But we haven't hit capacity yet on that, so we're doing good.
Mm. Or actually, too, that was what, Best Cuts or Great Clips that had that song, that the music commercial.
Right.
Yes, it was one of those two.
Yeah, it was a hair cutting place.
It was either Great Clips or Best Cuts.
Yeah.
One of the two.
We might have to look that up after this.
Yes.
Show.
Yeah.
You know, one other thing while we're on the topic of nature and the arts is that we have a nature writing contest going on right now. Mm-hmm. The deadline for that is April 21st, which I think is a Monday. So you can go on our website to learn more about the nature writing contest. I think it's on the front page in the bulletin board area, the yellow bulletin board area. So like I said, the deadline is April 21st. We accept poetry and prose, youth, adolescent, and adult categories. So there are certain word limits, but the only real thing about word limits that I'd like to mention is that one of the prizes this year is first place winners will be published in our newsletter, which goes out to every household in the county, which is kind of a big thing, I think.
Yeah. Voices of Nature.
Yeah, it's a Voices of Nature mm-hmm. newsletter. You can find that on our website, too. But so if you wanted to have your entire work published in the newsletter, it would have to be within a certain number of words. That's all on the application, which is on our website.
And isn't that going to be featured, the winners being able to do a reading at our Nature Art Festival, which has been running for, close to 30 years now.
Mm-hmm.
And,
the Nature Arts Festivals, yeah, that's at the first weekend of August.
Right.
At the West Woods. And there will be, on the Sunday of Nature Arts Festival, a special event for the winners of the Nature Writing Contest in which they'll be able to read their work in front of an audience or have someone else read their work in front of the audience and kind of be commended for that. It's another, you know, stage for our talent.
It might be a name that might be familiar. Peter Ward?
Yeah. Hi, Peter.
Yep. What a great contest for college students. Yeah. That's 90,000 people. Then, yeah.
Thanks, Peter. My little son, he's always looking out for me.
And weren't you just telling me that his vocabulary has expanded exponentially in the past month or so? So he's gearing up for his first entry in the nature writing contest.
That's right.
And we were just talking about how nature writing is a good thing for college people. Do you have volunteering or internships for college people?
Well,
or at least host them?
So much of what we do as far as program visitor services and so forth at Geauga Park District is could not be done without our volunteer corps. A wonderful, dedicated group of people of many ages that make a lot of what we do possible. And let's see. So there is volunteer opportunities from, I think, probably age 16 or right on up. And always welcoming new volunteers into our ranks. Now, as far as internships, yes, we do. I don't know if we have a formal internship program. It's more of a students come to us with their needs, whether they're high school students with community service or those in college or even high school that are taking certain classes that require some kind of a sort of a job shadowing type of experience. Mm-hmm. And we have, for a long time, been able to provide those kind of experiences, which have been very successful. In fact, some of those interns end up as seasonal employees and
so on. Yeah, you know, for volunteer opportunities, internship, mentorship type of opportunities, contact Holly Souter. She's our volunteer coordinator. She coordinates with the students as well. Her number is 440-279-0802.
Or go to our website and you'll see the volunteer opportunities link there.
Mm-hmm.
Very good.
All right, going back to some of the other events, I saw also on Friday you have something called Hubble's Greatest Hits.
Well, that brings us to Observatory Park, which is probably one of our biggest projects accomplishments of the last several years. This is up in Montville Township, and it is one of the few places in this part of the country, or country in general, that has earned a dark sky. Help me with that one.
It's an international dark sky park.
Being out there away from city lights and where the heavens are nicely visible. We have an observatory out there, the Oberle Observatory. We're currently working on plans to renovate and dedicate the former Case Western Reserve University's Nassau Observatory with its telescope. We have a wide range of programming out there. A lot of it focuses on astronomy. We have wonderful staff people up there. We refer to us naturalists as gnats, and we refer to them affectionately as our astronauts, and this would be one of their programs, Hubble's Greatest Hits, and I think that's featuring some of the wonderful images that the Hubble telescope has been able to capture in its journey over the past how many years it's been up there and about. So
they are. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm trying to think how many years it's been up. No, I can't.
Those astronauts, they host programs at Observatory Park every other Friday in the evening. But they also host open hours from 6 to 11 p.m. every Friday and Saturday that you can come use park telescopes to look up, see things that you wouldn't normally see, and enjoy the dark sky view.
That's right. And if the clouds don't cooperate with us, we have a planetarium there, and so they'll provide a very informative, entertaining program regardless.
About what you may or may not have seen up there.
Yeah.
So it's a great park. Even if you just come out during the day, there's a planetary trail that you can walk, that you can visit all the different planets and learn how much you'd weigh on those planets and fun facts about those planets.
Mm-hmm.
It's, again, one of those things that reaches the little kids, and it also reaches everyone up. There's something for everyone there.
And it's not just astronomy. We have a weather trail there, so meteorology is a main focus up there. Looking at the various concepts of give us our expressions of weather and our Lake Erie snowbelt climate. And we also, geology. We have a seismometer up there. So we have a seismographic. We're part of the Ohio Seismic Network. That our seismograph or seismometer does record earthquakes, little tremors, whether they be near or far away. And of course, up there in northern Geauga County and up into what's just to the north is eastern Lake County, that's a very seismically active area up there on an old fault line. So, we get some action up there on that.
One of our astronauts, Chris Mentrick, he's very good about sending us updates about what the seismograph is picking up, and we post that on our Facebook page. So this would be a good time to mention that we are on Facebook. So we are on Facebook. I think it's facebook.com/Geauga Park District. It's easy to find. So just click like on there, and we'll keep you updated on all the things that we're talking about now, including the various earthquakes that it picks up, and it'll pick up earthquakes from all across the world. It's pretty incredible. We're also on Twitter, Geauga Parks, and on Instagram, Geauga Parks.
And I guess I would add with the Facebook page and perhaps those other communication venues is that it's a participatory one. It's not just us putting out information. Mm-hmm. It's not a one-way communication. It's an opportunity for people to post their experiences in the park, photos and so forth like that I think really rounds out the park experience.
Yeah, it's It's neat because you don't even realize something is out there, you know, like a particular migratory bird. All of a sudden, just someone's sending a picture. We posted up there. Guess what's back? Here it is, you know. Go see it here.
As much as I'd like to be the first one to see it. No, I rely a lot on all the ears and eyes out there in the field to help keep everyone informed. So,
it's hard to be everywhere at once.
Yeah. I try, but you know.
It doesn't work out that well.
Exactly. All right, and I think that concludes the Kevin Baxter Now train wreck.
I saw him downstairs manning a table. I think he's busy doing something else. So.
All right, so go ahead and... for the outro, go ahead and say your names again.
This has been Dan Best, Senior Naturalist with Geauga Park District, coming to you live from Lakeland Community College.
Except I should do this. Yes. The news break. Or break.
There you go.
I thought I fixed the delay on that. Yeah, I should have done that. The breaking news one right underneath that. That I'm playing right now. This would be hilarious. No, here.
Next visit, we need more special effects. That's our.
How do we fix that? Darn it!
Great. All right, so Dan Best.
That was Dan Best. I'm Sandy Ward.
I'm Tom.
And I'm just that random person.
Absolutely.
I just like doing that.
And have a great day.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you very much.